Hey everyone, it's Evan here from The Trade Risk on Tuesday, February 6th, here with a midweek market recap video. We're going to cover the current market environment and all the major markets. We're going to skip the sector analysis and really focus in on the market environment. I think that's what everybody wants to hear about today. And it's been a crazy week already. It's only Tuesday. It feels like we've already traded throughout an entire week of action, but it's only Tuesday here. We came rallying back to finish up 2% in the S&P 500. We're going to look at this daily chart in just a moment, but first, let's take a look at the bigger picture here, this perspective on the weekly chart, as we like to always start our videos looking at. And you can see here, we are down still 2.3% here on the week. It's only Tuesday, so we have plenty of days left in this week for this weekly bar to really change its shape. But for now, we're seeing a sizable gap, a sizable bounce off of the lows of this week, which came in right around 259 or so at the start of today's trading. And we did finish up here right around 268 or so to finish out the day on Tuesday. Now, a couple of things to note when we're looking at this weekly chart. First things first is the very clear sort of weekly follow through that we saw from last week's trading. So, of course, last week we kind of opened up right underneath the Friday, the January 26th highs, and we basically sold off all week, closed on the lows, and then we added to those gains, accelerated those gains even at the start of this week so far. Next, note the volume, which is actually already eclipsed last week's trading. We've already done over 600 million shares, and it's only Tuesday. Last week was the highest volume week we saw throughout in all of 2017, so you'd have to go back to election time in 2016 to get the volume we traded last week. And again, it's only Tuesday here, and we're already basically eclipsed last week's volume. So lots of shares trading hand, lots of excitement here in markets. Next, notice the lows here as where those sort of coincide with this rising trend line from the election, say the election start of this rally right here back in November of 2016. If we were to draw this trend line, it's not so precise, but you can see it came in to this general area here and bounced sharply on that first test of it. I'm not going to, you know, say that this trend line holds any magical power or this was where the market was heading to, but coincidentally, you know, for frame of reference anyway, we can look at sort of this level as a general reference point. So as it stands right now, the weekly chart above the 20 period so far, we'll see where it closes out the week, but getting follow through and below the 8 period, broke the accelerated trends, but not still a tremendous amount of damage here on the weekly chart, even given everything that we've seen. Now, when we go to the daily chart, that certainly changes. We do see some damage here. We see some very large ranges relative to the past several months, really the past 14 months of trading here in the S&P 500. So when we look at this week here, Monday is where we finally saw some real sort of panic and fear set in. Monday's trading session, particularly, you know, in the afternoon when the selling really started to accelerate below 270, 272 or so, you know, that felt very much like a 2015 type of trading environment, or maybe even a Brexit, I guess, in 2016. But we haven't seen that type of fear. We haven't seen the VIX elevated so much, and we just haven't seen, you know, the ranges really expand in such a long time. And unless you're actively trading cryptocurrency or following that type of market, we as traders haven't been exposed to this type of volatility in such a long time. So it's very easy to have gotten caught off guard here on Monday, particularly if you're in the camp of saying, well, Friday ended horribly or poorly, you know, chances are it's time to buy the dip again. And anybody that had that type of mentality who were trying to sort of buy too early here on Monday really felt the pain of this accelerated selling to the downside. So 4% down. We posted this yesterday on our site here, The Trade Risk. If you go to the blog, you can see a number of different statistics and different indicators, market internals mainly, things that I like to look at when we start to get these large outsized moves. And, you know, you could throw up almost any indicator here, and it's going to be an oversold or stretched or extreme territory. A few of the ones that I like to look at, percentage of stocks that are above a 10-day moving average. Now, at the time of actually copying this one in here, I thought the value was actually at 10%, but turns out at the close yesterday, we were at a 1% value for the number of stocks. So 1% of stocks were above a 10 SMA, 10 simple day moving average for the S&P 500. That's something we haven't seen in multiple years. You can see on a standard deviation basis, way below here on the three standard deviation move lower. If we were to look at the NIMO, the McClellan oscillator that measures the momentum in the advanced decline line, you can see you'd have to go all the way back to 2011 to see a reading of 118 on this scale. Everybody's scale is a little bit different. And we also saw the number of 52-week highs picking up to their highest levels since 2015, that more volatile kind of August or really July throughout the end of the year in 2015. That type of trading environment was the last time we've seen the number of 52-week stocks hit these levels. So from a perspective of fear out there and extreme moves and measuring the intensity of the selling here, we were really breaking records basically across the board or setting new highs across the board on multi-year types of levels. So even though the selling only lasted, say, these 2 days primarily, you could dial it back to 6 days if you want to start from the 29th, the selling was intense over this time. So on a duration basis, it didn't happen over a long period of time, but the selling was fierce. And that paved the way for, yes, a gap down today, but a very quick sort of fade or rally off of the gap down. We opened right around 259 or so. We had this quick flurry of trading, a little bit south for about 50 cents or so. And then we just kind of zoomed higher here and filled the gap and then proceeded to sort of chop around throughout the trading session and then ultimately finishing strong. So when I look at this market overall and I think about the different scenarios going forward, looking at the indicators like we just recapped here, there is definitely enough fear in here or enough capitulation based on some of these readings in here to believe that a short-term low is now in. So I think the evidence, there is evidence that certainly stacks in that favor, but nothing can be convincingly, we can't be sure of that. And we still have to absolutely manage risk here. And I also, want to caution people because I think a lot of people think very binary about this and saying, is the low in or do we have more to go? And even if the low is in here, it doesn't mean that we aren't in store for some wild trading with some wild swings back and forth and maybe a bunch of retests back down to this 259. Maybe this level is more or less going to be the low for the short to intermediate term, but it doesn't mean that the market has to just resume higher and V-shape. I know it's good at that. We very well could see that. That is a scenario that we just rally right back to highs from here. But I think, this time around, this type of retracement is different in a lot of different metrics. Just looking at volatility, how it's still up here, it did retrace today, but it's still trading around a 30 VIX, which is something we haven't seen in quite a long time. If we look at put to call ratio, and again, any of those market internal indicators, we know that the selling was really intense over the past several days, which is different than any of the other declines that led to these nice, easy sort of V-shaped rallies over the past 14 months or so. So some thoughts to really think about. I think, again, there is enough evidence to think that the bottom has been put in, but I don't think it necessarily means it has to be an easy rally back to new highs. I think getting some follow through tomorrow will be important, will be key, to retrace, even 30, 40, 50% of this move back up to this 275 level, I think is reasonable. And then waiting to see how the market acts if it can even muster up a rally and follow through tomorrow. If not, then of course the lows here from Tuesday are very much sort of in in our consideration for short-term support to hold. Now, looking back here, a couple of other sort of a couple of other notes here, again, with one with respect to market internals. There's this concept of breadth thrust. So in other words, the number of stocks that are participating in a move, the magnitude of a breadth thrust in this case would be, say, the McClellan down here. This is a sharp move into negative territory. Throughout this rally, throughout 2017, these types of moves have always been terminating moves. In other words, these have always been the buyable event that marks the low and then the market proceeds to rally. But historically speaking, there's lots of evidence out there that sharp breath thrusts in either direction can either terminate moves, or they could also be the start of a change of character, of a more volatile environment to come. And I really basically would just point our attention back to the number of 52-week lows and highs here. This flare-up that we're seeing here in February of the number of stocks hitting new 52-week lows, we need to ask ourselves, we need to pay attention to see, is this just going to be a November type event where we have this kind of brief period of volatility, chop around for a couple of weeks and then go back to making new highs? Or does this turn into a scenario like May or June of 2015, which sets us up for, a 3 to 4, 6 month, some would call this a bear rally, a bear market, but just, generally speaking, volatile and uncertain sort of sideways choppy conditions. I don't think we have enough evidence at this point to point to one or the other. I think right now we need to pay attention to how price action responds in the next couple of days, how it finishes out the week. And we also want to pay attention to market internals, just like the 52-week lows and high list, because I think those give some good clues in situations and scenarios like we're seeing. So there's a lot of thoughts and a lot of facts and a lot of information we just covered there. Basically, I think it's always important to keep an open mind. Remember, you don't have to trade every day. If you were buying the dips all the way up through 2017 and you like trading above the 20 period SMA or a trend trading strategy like that, this is a different market environment. This is the biggest pullback we've seen. Things have changed. Maybe we will resume back to our old landscape, but it's going to take at least some time to reset some of this damage, to get back above some of these moving averages, and just to let these charts more or less reset. It's going to take time. So don't be out there in a rush to trade. Don't think that we're still in this same very sleepy environment, because indication by these 2 days, you clearly know that something has changed. Maybe it was a quick capitulation, but again, I think we need to keep an open mind to understand that we could see more volatility to come. So lots of thoughts there, fairly long-winded in the analysis today, but hopefully some of that helps to at least give you some different scenarios to think about. I know for my strategy, for my time frame, I do have some exposure on here, so buying some stocks here at the close, but still keeping a large position of cash. I am interested in playing for potential continuation higher in some stocks that held up particularly well, but again, I'm not willing to jump in with 2 feet now and just blindly buy everything. I need some more proof before we go back into a sort of core allocation exposure mode. So that's the S&P 500. Again, note the volume down here, breaking records across the board. I think we get a lot to chew on there. Let's see how we finish out this week. Let's see what happens to the VIX. Let's watch market internals. These are all things that are moving very fast now, and I think we need to keep a close eye on. And again, risk management. If you got caught here, that's fine. It's okay to be wrong. It's not okay to stay wrong. So hopefully, if you got caught here, you now sort of are back on, back behaving, I guess, following your strategy and position sizing properly, and ready to see what the market throws at us over the next week or two. So IWM, let's go here next. You can see weekly chart suffering the most damage. It is still below the 20-period EMA. It is down 2.69%. And more importantly for me, it's below this 150 level. It's just barely there. It closed right at it this week. But for me, I don't like when stocks get trapped or break back below major areas of supply. And to me, there's a lot of supply that traded in here between basically 149 and 153, approximately three months of trading in here with lots of chop. And when markets start to get trapped back below that, I get a little concerned. If we bounce back up, if we reject quickly and we break back up into the top end of this range, that's obviously the bullish scenario there. But if we hang out, the longer we hang out under 149, the less I like this immediate sort of price action here in the IWM. So for me, I'd like to see this pick up. Huge volume coming in, nice turnaround today. Again, maybe the capitulation is in. Let's see if we get that follow through. Let's pay attention to the weekly close. I would still say on a relative basis, the Russell 2000 is the weakest. And when we look at the NASDAQ 100, you can see here is the strongest of the bunch right now. It had this nice turnaround this day as well, 2.65% to the upside. It's only down 1.4% this week. It's actually almost closing back above the 8-period. It retested a pretty important 156.50 level, which is, again, kind of like what we just mentioned in the IWM. There's a lot of supply that traded roughly in this sort of, let's see if I can get this drawn, a couple of months of trading right inside or right around this 152 to 156 level. And we kind of came back, tested the top end of it, and we ended up holding there and rallying off of it. So the position wise on a relative basis, I like the Qs much more than I like the IWM here, just because it is much further off the highs and is trapped underneath that supply. But I think both have some work to do. Both are technically sort of broken here in the short term, need some time to repair these charts, to get some follow through, so on and so forth. So that's the market environment overall. That's the way I see it. Some different scenarios there. I basically am in the camp right now of not being strongly all in one side or the other. I'm rarely in that camp to begin with, but particularly now as we see a transitionary market, I think it's now more important than ever to be patient, stay selective, and focus on risk management. So let's get into some other markets here. We'll go to TLT next. You can see here on the week, actually positive. A little bit of that fear that we saw in equities on Monday found its way into TLT, even despite this major breakdown last week. It's still technically in a pretty ugly spot, trading and holding below this 123 level. I say the longer it holds below there, the more likely we see lower prices and the more sort of bearish of an outlook that I have on it. So right now, TLT, I don't see anything that is too appealing right there. I do note the high volume single day reversal here on Monday. But again, I'd say that's a single day event until proven otherwise. If we start to get back above 120, 270, this general area, then I would start to change my tune on TLT on, a false breakdown, which could be the case if we ended up seeing a strong rally right back up and through this level. But until that happens, I got to imagine sellers here are in control. Gold next was under some pressure today, down a little bit on the week, 0.8%, coming back into some of the rising moving averages there on the weekly chart. Again, I sort of welcome a pullback here in GLD. It's had a very strong run since the December lows. We're seeing some big volume come in, starting to technically get pretty sloppy in here. So we'll see if it can pull back a little bit further, maybe come back down to this 124 level where it found some support and chop around, build out a base, and then maybe that leads to some continuation pattern next month. We'll have to see. Silver still looks like it's in a fairly tough spot here. It broke through the lows here of Wednesday. Again, a lot of supply in this general area of 1590 or so. So the consolidation here, I really think it just needs to hold sooner rather than later. The deeper this pullback becomes, the less attractive silver looks to me. It was looking nice in here. In fact, we actually tried to take a trade in this and we got stopped out. over the past week or two. But now that it's, you know, broken below recent lows, it's kind of making new lows on the year here. It is much less interesting to me unless it sees a sharp move back into this range and back into this consolidation. Next, if we go to oil, oil pulling back a bit here, 2.61% along with equities this week. You can see technically still not a ton of damage here whatsoever. It's a shallow pullback. It's trading at the pivot lows here from mid-January. And so far, it is trying to hold on, even though it is breaking, closing below that 20 period. You know, maybe a larger pullback is finally in store for USO. It's been kind of trending fairly clean to the upside for many months now. So maybe a little bit more of a pullback would be a welcoming sort of development. And finally, natural gas, UNG, has gotten pretty weak here over the past several days and had this sharp reversal, and it just really, you know, from $27 all the way down to $23 in just five or so trading days. You do have this sort of look here if you're a pattern trader of some type of inverted pattern of let's see if we can get this drawn. So if we look like that, right, and if we can hold kind of roughly in this area, I know it's pretty sloppy, you're going to kind of squint your eyes. You can call it what you want, but what I see basically is if a higher low can get put in and hold where some of this previous structure was and not retrace this full rally since the beginning of December, you know, that might be a kind of final line in the sand for the bulls to hold on to and save right around this $23 level. If we can start to lift up from here, get back up to this old, to these recent highs, maybe have some more action in that. But for now, natural gas, just not that interesting, kind of gave back quite a bit here in very sharp fashion. And, you know, I just gonna have to wait for a sort of a better setup. So I think that's everything. Again, let me see, going over my notes. I think we covered everything there. So a lot on the market environment, but hopefully you guys navigating it just fine. And hopefully we have some ideas and some levels to pay attention to heading into the end of this week. So thank you so much for watching. As always, if you like the videos, do subscribe to our YouTube channel. Thanks so much, and talk to you again on Friday. Mm-hmm.